नमस्कार, वी आर सेलिब्रेटिंग वर्ल्ड ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग वीक एंड टुडे इज द सिक्स्थ डे ऑफ द सेम एंड इन लास्ट फाइव डेज वी हैव इंटरव्यूड अ लार्ज नंबर ऑफ मदर्स एज वेल एज एक्सपर्ट्स वर्किंग इन डिफरेंट फील्ड्स रिलेटेड टू ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग एज वेल एज लैक्टेशन. इन द सेम सीक्वेंस टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू इंट्रोड्यूस यू अ मदर हु हैज ब्रोकन ऑल द स्टीरियोटाइप्स. She has ventured miles out of her comfort zone, physically as well as emotionally, with the determination to exclusively breastfeed her baby. So, I am happy to introduce you all a super mom, Mukta, which I must say, Mukta is a girl who has completed her research work post delivery. So, this is a matter which is really commendable because usually the girls lose all their interest as well as the tempo to work hard in their fields, respective fields. But she has worked for to get her PhD degrees during the pregnancy time, as well as she has worked hard during the delivery time and post delivery also. And during this time, when she was breastfeeding the baby was traveling along with her, off field or on field. So this is what is Mukta. And now Mukta, kudos to you. And now you please start your breastfeeding journey from day one. What do you want to actually tell all of the mothers around you, as well as who are in the field, who are actually waiting to either deliver or are breastfeeding right now?
So Mukta, okay, thank you so much, Shilpi, for your gracious words. One thing I just would like to say that I would definitely not call myself a super mom or a superwoman. That's a syndrome I'm scared of. I'm a very normal girl, and I just tried my best with the help of people who were around me, with my family members, and of course a lot of emotional as well as professional support from Dr. Taru. To be a mother who can still work, who can still achieve her dreams. And for that, it is not just my determination, but it was, it was a lot of other factors which also were in my favor, I must say. But thank you very much for this introduction. To start with, I would say that because I have been in the field of health and public health, I was under impression that I was completely aware of and, had knowledge about breastfeeding, the importance of it during my pregnancy. My pregnancy was pretty smooth, and I was just looking forward to the journey of breastfeeding, exclusive breastfeeding for the first 6 months. However, and my delivery also happened. I mean, it was a normal delivery. However, I remember after delivery, when I saw my daughter for the first time, the first thought that came to my mind was, okay, what am I supposed to do? What is that first step that I need to take so that, this journey of breastfeeding takes off smoothly? I felt completely clueless. Although my family members were completely, supportive of breastfeeding, the doctors and nurses were supportive of it. However, I was just baffled with the process, to start with that process, and that guidance and support and having a lactation consultant in the hospital was lacking. And I think that was the first instance when I realized that you don't only need gynecologists and, pediatricians around you during this entire process. You definitely need a lactation specialist because this is a crucial part of this journey. After taking help of one of the doctors in the hospital, later I also spoke with Taru. My journey of breastfeeding started off pretty smoothly, I would say. There was no issues of latching, or because I have a background in physiotherapy, I kind of knew different positions that the child can be in your lap, what all different positions are comfortable for mother, for child. So that I would say started off pretty smoothly, and until my daughter was, if I remember correct, she was like 3 months old, when I went to a pediatrician in another city. I had shifted to another city by then. When I went for a general checkup to a pediatrician, and she was weighing few maybe milligrams and grams less than expected. And the first sentence that came to me from that pediatrician was, are you breastfeeding her exclusively? And I said, yes. And he just said, stop doing that. You need to immediately shift to cow milk. He just told me what all things I'm supposed to do, take the cow milk, how, you know, the vomit, then whatever, add some water to it. I just remember how I felt doubtful of myself. And I was completely clueless as a mother who was so determined to, you know, exclusively breastfeed her child for 6 months. The first thing, I was fortunate mother who knew that there is something called as lactation specialist. I was fortunate to know a lactation specialist whom I could just call. What about all other mothers who get this message instantly from a pediatrician that, you know, just stop breastfeeding. She's not gaining weight. There is no other conversation. You know, nobody's telling you why not breastfeeding and why cow milk, or you know, what are other options? What is mother facing any other issues because of which maybe there is not enough weight gain? There is no one to tell you how to plot a growth chart on your own. So I think you know, I just felt like I was fortunate to just call my lactation consultant over phone. Who gave me that emotional support which I needed at that time the most, who told me how to put a growth chart. Do not get, you know, so, you know, I just, I felt lack of confidence, absolute lack of confidence. She gave me that confidence in the journey of breastfeeding. She told me to continue exclusive breastfeeding. And I think that is the time, especially during first 6 months of you know, period, when every mother needs. If there is even one moment when someone like a pediatrician is doubting your, you know, breastfeeding, in the breastfeeding journey, I think that
one thing is there
takes away your Mukta.
One thing is, yeah, there, Mukta. 3 months, I mean, till 3 months of age, you were exclusively breastfeeding the baby. You, yeah, might be taking baby to a pediatrician for her, even if nothing for, yeah, health concerns, but you must be taking the baby for normal, right, vaccination. So you never pointed it out that, yeah, you are not making, the pediatrician not making a growth chart, or none of the pediatricians, as you have, as I introduced you, I mean, you have shifted so many places also during those, right, 6 months, right, and everything. So you might be changing pediatricians, but no one actually pointed it out that there were no growth charts. Or
right. So nobody taught me the importance of growth chart. First of all, nobody pointed out that I could also plot a growth chart. Second, and third, on my daughter's vaccination cards, they would just put stickers for immunization, you know, the dates and the stickers for immunization. I didn't really realize that, okay, if I'm shifting from one city to another city, it would be actually helpful if the first pediatrician plots a growth chart, so that it will be, you know, helpful for the next pediatrician in another city to kind of track the you know, the track, the weight gain. So yes, that did not happen.
But later, when you actually learned to make a growth chart, you could have done it by yourself. You don't need a pediatrician or any helper to, right, make the growth chart, isn't it?
Absolutely. Okay.
So that is the best
completely
part.
Agree.
Okay. Yeah. So
yes, absolutely. And unfortunately, pediatricians don't have time, you know, to sit with you and show you how to plot it. Most of the pediatricians are very busy. They don't have even time to communicate. You know, I mean, I would definitely talk about it later, but out of 4 to 5 pediatricians, I had to take, you know, my daughter or two. I'm so sorry. Only 2 pediatricians had spent time, like 10-15 minutes with a mother to understand what are her, you know, concerns, and gave time for that patient-physician communication. But otherwise, I mean, yeah.
This is actually, yes, this needs to be work on. Yes, the mothers in the ENC classes should be taught how to make a growth chart, isn't it?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. Then please carry on.
After the period of 6 months, I must say one thing that, I mean, this is a message I would like to give to all mothers. My husband has been very, very supportive and actively supportive of my, you know, entire breastfeeding journey. However, there is one thing for sure is that sometimes even fathers don't know what kind of support mothers need. You know, they are also trying their best. Many a times it is just that, you know, he would come and give me a pillow, extra pillow, so that I feel comfortable. Sometimes he would just give me some juice or, you know, some water or some fruit to eat. However, sometimes you really have to be vocal about what support you need. Sometimes mothers just need father to sit there, just be with her when she's, you know, exclusively breastfeeding. Because
you are talking about the emotional support.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I think it is not just providing that, you know, technical support, like, you know, providing pillows and giving water to drink to mother. It is also father's involvement in this breastfeeding journey. So, you know, if father is asking you, I mean, your husband is asking you if there is any issue, if he's actually seeing a baby taking feed from you, I think those moments are also very special. Even for that bond between father and a child. So I feel that all mothers should sort of learn to be vocal about these, you know, very nuanced issues, I would say. But yeah, I mean, I was quite open about these needs, and I could share that with my husband. So it has been a very beautiful journey. After 6 months, the next struggle starts, and I think that struggle is between how to find that delicate balance between complementary feeds and you know, continuation of breastfeeding. I think do you have any question, or should I?
No, you please carry on.
So I remember feeling confused because you know, you don't exactly know, the child is also learning to refuse food, right? Child is also learning to be independent. Child learns to say yes, no, you know, refusal, then throwing food away, all kinds of tantrums start very, you know, very soon. And I think that is the new kind of a struggle, which is very new to any mother. I think that was the time again, when I talked to Taru about how to guess and how to make that decision that no, right now is the time when she needs a feed. What are those good habits for complementary feed, you know, whenever she's learning to eat solid food? What are those good habits that even mother needs to learn? You know, sometimes it's like, you know, from stories and you know, from songs from your grandmom and mom, how mother is running behind the child, taking plate and, you know, pyar se, you know, khilana usko, just run behind that child and try to feed your child. I think learning, sort of unlearning these habits as a mother and learning what are some very good habits so that your child learns to explore food, explore textures, explore smells. And also your child learns that whenever he or she is hungry, if she is saying dudu, are you supposed to give feed or is it a time for a complimentary feed? Is it a time for me? You know, all these, this is a very, I would say, complex process. You don't learn these things from one day.
I interfere you into this. I want to, this is a very scientific process. It's a very scientific process and it happens step by step. There are a few written steps which has to be, I guess, followed, which has to be followed in initial days when you are weaning off the baby and putting him to the complementary or introducing the complementary food. And if it is done properly in the sense that when you introduce complementary food, the complementary food should be in comparison to the mother's milk nutritionally also. If it is nutritionally comparable to the breast milk, then I guess child will not reject the food. And her body will not demand for your breast milk for more than the time which you are ready to offer or which you should offer scientifically. So how did you got into this easy process of introducing the complementary food? That is what my question will be right now.
So I would say that initially when I had no knowledge of this scientific process at all. I just thought that I don't remember exactly till when, but almost I would say for several weeks I didn't even think of textures, then the proportion of breastfeed and complementary feed. I didn't even think of giving child time to explore solid food, you know, giving something in her hand. I was just feeding her some kind of liquidish food as a complimentary feed. So in Marathi, we call it Nachnichi Lapshi. Or, you know, I just thought that because she has been on breast milk for 6 months, I just decided myself that this is the food that she will be able to digest without any consultation to anyone. And I think after that, there was this struggling period when I just realized that my child was getting irritated. I was struggling to realize whether I'm giving her enough breast milk or not. That was the time when, we were trying to decide whether she should be going to the daycare or not. I think that was the time when I took this advice. But even I struggled initially when I decided for myself that no, she should be still on some kind of
Mukta, this was the very struggle period for you. Definitely you were working, you were trying to get your research works done. So till what time did you manage with the daycare, with the complimentary food, as well as with the breast milk? Till what time were you able to manage?
I breastfed Anahita for 3 years. And Anahita, I mean, my daughter has been going to daycare since she was 1 year old. One thing which was it was in favor of me was that the daycare was still in the campus of the university I was living in. I was studying in. So that was quite helpful because I could make visits to that daycare. I could, feed her if I wanted and, if it was the right time. Complimentary food, the daycare supervisor was, I would say was pretty open to learn what I was, trying to tell her about complimentary food. They had very good habits which were taught to their staff about not forcing food, to the child. Yeah. I was sharing my experience when I needed to travel abroad for almost 10 days when my daughter was 9 months old. And of course, as you know by now, that I was breastfeeding her as well as, of course, she was on complimentary feed. I was determined that I would pump enough milk for her. I would store it and, I will try my best to continue her breastfeeding. I was making frantic calls to my lactation consultant. I learned the entire process, ordered steel containers. I started pumping regularly, labeling them, putting dates on them, storing them in a refrigerator. I was also giving all sorts of instructions to my husband, who was going to take care of her, continuation of breastfeeding when he was going to travel to another city. And one day we realized that while going to one city and from there they had to take, there was another car travel for again next few hours to reach their destination. How exactly are you going to take care of the cold storage? I remember, I just felt so helpless because I had already started storing my milk, okay? That was a time when I made several calls to specialists. I remember actually going and meeting a biological engineering professor from my university to understand how, how I can maintain, who is not a scientist, I would say. I mean, who is not a scientist in a life science profession. Tell me in a simple language, how can I take care of this cold storage for my, breast milk? He suggested me some ways, but he said, you definitely need some support from, airlines, because you're carrying this sort of with biomaterial. Told me how to order these ice packs. I ordered them. I had a box ready. And we realized that even though airlines, we called up airline by which we were traveling, and they were just clueless about my question. They just did not understand what I'm asking for. I tried to explain it to them, but they just did not have answer for that question. And that gave me an insight that airlines are just so clueless about mothers' needs. It's not just, you know, having a feeding room on the airport. There are so many other needs that babies and mothers have. We also called up, some transport agencies if they could carry it. And at some point, I realized that I have to stop these efforts, just try my best through this thermocol box and putting these ice packs around. My husband carried that breast milk. However, when he reached the city, he was just not sure whether the breast milk remained of good quality, because there was a long travel by car, you know, after reaching one destination. Baby refused that milk. So only for those 9 days, we had to shift. I mean, he had to shift onto formula milk because she was not ready to take that stored milk. However, my consultant had given me a very good advice that it is fine for 9 days if at all, because of lack of resources, if you cannot continue, the baby does not continue breastfeeding. What I needed to do was throughout my journey to the US, in the international flights, during my conference, I carried my pump. Kept pumping my milk away. I used to throw it. I used to go to the restroom, pump my milk and come back. I used to feel sleepy, but I would just do it. And for 9 days, I was continuously making efforts so that as soon as I return and meet my baby, she would be again back on, breastfeeding. And that I could do successfully.
When nine days you were not around your daughter, at that time also you tried your level best to at least your milk supply should not go down. That is fantastic.
Absolutely.
And what happened when you returned back? So what was the first reaction?
I just had that little anxiety when I saw her. However, as soon as she saw me and as soon as I just took her to my chest, she was able to just smoothly continue breastfeeding. I mean, she took that feed and I could see that satisfaction on both of our faces. I could feel that. So that was a very, sort of satisfying moment for me.
Perfect. That is perfect. And so, of course, that also you started breastfeeding with the complementary feeding things and all. So that was again, post 9 days, everything was normal as usual. Is it?
Yes. Absolutely.
So till 3 years, this was just 9 months old, baby. This was the time when baby was 9 months old. So didn't you faced any problem till you are telling us that you have fed the baby till 3 years?
As I told you, during first 6 months, the struggles are of a different kind. After 6 months, when you're trying to balance between complementary feed and breastfeeding, the struggles are a little different. And I would say after 1 year, or I would say even beyond 1.5 years, struggles are again of a different kind. IT kind of starts questioning the need of, continuation of breastfeeding. Several people see it as ki kyun itni zabardasti kar rahi ho, kyun itna khud ko kos rahi ho. It's that kind of a perception of continuation of breastfeeding after 1.5 years. I must say that my immediate family members, again my in-laws, parents and husband, were supportive of it. Of course, we used to have discussions about कि वाइल यू आर डूइंग योर पीएचडी यू नो इट वाज अ स्ट्रेसफुल लाइफ बिकॉज माय हस्बैंड हैड टू मूव टू अनदर सिटी अगेन बिकॉज ऑफ हिज जॉब ट्रांसफर यू नो दैट इज द टाइम आई फील इट इज नॉट जस्ट लैक्टेशन कंसल्टेंट यू शुड बी टॉकिंग टू बट इफ देर इज एनी अदर स्ट्रगल for example if you are really feeling psychologically exhausted just giving answers to everyone why you are continuing with breastfeeding sometimes you also do need professional help from a psychologist I think I have been taking help whenever required from my psychologist talking about your concerns learning to deal with just stop it I'm just tired of giving answers now is the time I should stop but then from inside I somewhere knew that no I think I should be continuing still try my best to continue feeding my daughter so that is the time when I think most mothers struggle because first 6 months usually people are empathetic because you know they look at mother as a new mother after 1.5 years mothers are back to their work several mothers are back to their daily routines and they really need I have been taking that help I had taken that help whenever required
So Mukta, whether you require the help of lactation consultant or a psychiatrist or a psychologist, you were determined to breastfeed. That is actually just the perfect way of breastfeeding the baby. So